My name is Christopher Adamson, and I'm reading a short piece from My Friend George, which appears in Exile, Volume 35, Number 1. Outside, there's only air, a thing you see through. You don't really see the air, so it's hard to tell how fast you're going. Not like when you're in a car and you see trees and fields and sometimes billboards rushing by. It's just the three of us. I'm next to the window, Aunt Fern's beside me. Uncle Marshall's across the aisle. I've been thinking about this trip ever since that day I was in bed with a cold and crept down the stairs to the landing and heard them talking about me. Aunt Fern asking if I'd be coming on the holiday. Of course he'll come, Uncle Marshall said. It would be wrong to leave Richard, that's me, at home. Being left is all I've known, he said. No, I won't be a problem, he said, as I'm just a pup asleep by 8:30. That same evening, I learned Victoria wouldn't be joining us since she's at school studying to be a nurse. She wants to be my big sister and says I can call her Vicky. I am glad of that and glad to be living with her parents, who are my aunt and uncle. There was no need to change my last name since my dead father and my uncle have the same last name. Aunt Fern and Uncle Marshall have said I can call them mother and father if I want to, and sometimes I do. Death is a thing you can't change once it's happened. I was just 7 and lived in another house at the time. Vicky says she was worried about me because I stood at the window all day waiting for them to come back. I remember Uncle Marshall being there once and him asking Nanny Alyana if I was still going to the window. I heard him say, "It has to stop right away. He needs to understand they're gone and not coming back." Not long after that day, Uncle Marshall told me that he and Aunt Fern were going to be my parents and I'd be coming to live with them. He's got to get on with his life. That's another thing Uncle Marshall says, but only when he doesn't think I'm around. I'm looking forward to the day when people think of Aunt Fern and Uncle Marshall as my mom and dad. Maybe then the older boys at Elmwood Avenue Public School won't point at me when I'm lining up after recess. That's Ricky Bartram, the orphan. They're just joking around, but I don't like it, so I tell the boys my age that I live with my mom and dad, except I don't think they believe me because I have dark brown hair and my aunt and uncle have pale blonde hair, and I'm short for my age and they're tall, taller than most grown-ups. I have a pug nose, and Uncle Marshall has a long nose like an eagle's, and I'm pudgy, and he's bony, with a jaw like Lamont Tilden, the man who reads the news at 6 o'clock. I don't look much like my aunt, either. Her nose turns red in the sun unless she puts on a lotion. Her friend Betty Fraser thinks she's willowy. One day I heard Betty Fraser telling Aunt Fern that Uncle Marshall is lucky to have her. Vicky says I look a little like my real mother, who was petite, which is a French word which means small. I don't want to be small. I don't think anyone does. Not much longer, Uncle Marshall says, looking over at me. He's no longer speaking with the man beside him. Earlier, I had heard them talking about the terrible thing that happened last year, President Kennedy getting shot while riding in the back of a convertible. I like living in my uncle's big white house on the lake. It has a pink roof that's visible in winter through the trees from the dead end of Mohawk Road. My room faces north, so I don't see the lake, the gulls and ducks on the water. I see the woods instead, chickadees and cardinals, crows and starlings. I wish I could see birds out the window of this airplane. All I can see is empty blue air and a silvery haze in the distance. My gray flannel trousers are making me itchy, though. And it's boring just sitting here. So I ask Aunt Fern if I can walk to the back of the plane. She wants to know if I need to go to the bathroom. When I say no, she says I should remain in my seat because I'll just get in the way of the stewardess who still has to collect our lunch trays on a trolley. So I switch between looking out the window and turning the pages of the Iliad and the Odyssey, my favorite picture book. It's good news when the pilot tells us to fasten our seatbelts and prepare for landing. We drop down through clouds and then the earth looms up, everything on the ground growing larger, the woods and fields, and I can even see little cars and green hedges by the side of the road. When the tires bump down on the runway, The people on the plane begin talking to each other in loud voices. We don't get off right away. We have to wait till they roll a metal staircase to the front of the plane. I follow my aunt and uncle down the steps and then cross the cracked pavement. It's warm, like being in a steamy bathroom, and too bright to look up at the sun. Inside the terminal, we stand around till our suitcases appear on the carousel, which is a rubber belt that turns around and around like a ride at the carnival. Outside, the sidewalk is sprinkled with pink blossoms from the flowering bushes. The air here is very fresh, thick with oxygen, Uncle Marshall says, because we are at sea level. We get into a boxy green car, a Mercedes-Benz with hump fenders and white wall tires. Whenever the driver turns to the left or right, an arrow the color of a duck's bill flips up at the side of the car. The two arrows have a little bulb inside, so you can see them when it's dark. The road winds through fields that my uncle says are sugar cane, except the plants are young and won't be cut for many months. Every now and then, we pass huts with thatched roofs, shanties, my uncle calls them. Mangy dogs bark as we drive by.